Chapter 9, Blood Purge. When Wino and I walked into the chow hall, Building 3 had already been released. Chino, Paco, Sleepy, and another homeboy by the name of Vincent Chente Roybal from San Jose were already sitting at the tables waiting for us. Chente was just a North Daniel, but like Wino, he volunteered to go with us. As Wino and I stood in line waiting to pick up our trays, I looked around the chow hall to surmise the temper of the Sureños and whether or not they sensed anything. The atmosphere seemed calm and our targets were in there. This was definitely our perfect opportunity to make our move and catch them off guard. By now, I could feel my heart beating through my chest and my stomach felt like a small Armageddon was erupting inside. I was nervous, but I was ready. When Wino and I finally got our trays and sat down, I offered my tray to a black guy I knew from the county jail in San Francisco. It was hamburgers, one of the better meals they serve, but tonight there'd be no Burger King because my appetite was shot out. Unbeknownst to this guy who thought he'd be eating a double stack burger, he never even got a chance to enjoy it. 1 minute the chow hall was relatively calm, like it usually was any other day, and the next minute it was utter chaos and complete pandemonium. It quickly escalated into a blood purge. After the initial assault and the unsuspecting targets were all hit, the rest of the chow hall exploded into an all-out food fight. Trays, salt and pepper shakers, cups, and spoons became flying projectiles. As soon as the stabbings were carried out, the chow hall systematically divided into two. Sureños and whites were on one side, and the blacks were with us on the other. Everybody started yelling and the adrenaline rush spread over the entire chow hall. When the gunners finally made it into the towers directly above us, they ordered everyone to lie down on the ground and not to move. There wasn't any part of the floor that wasn't covered with dinner trays and everything else that was served for dinner. The Sureños had finally been the victims this time, and this was a day that was definitely a long time coming. As crazy as it may sound, I remember feeling an overwhelming sense of triumph. I felt like I was serving my country, and my country was Northern California. In all, 9 Sureños and 2 Border Brothers were hit. You could actually smell the blood in the air. The Border Brothers were cases of mistaken identity, but in situations like this, no one was checking IDs or asking questions. They were just collateral damage. That night, we were all taken to ADSEG and given lockup orders for being suspected of participating in a melee between the Northern and Southern Hispanic inmates. They couldn't pinpoint who used a weapon or who was actually even involved, so no one picked up a DA referral, but we all got the same lockup orders. I couldn't believe these Sureños were stupid enough to let their guard down. It was too easy. I remember thinking, damn, man, we should have done this a long time ago. They were too vulnerable, and this exposed them. A few days later, we all went to our initial classification review. They unexpectedly gave me and Chente the option of going back out to the yard or to get put up for endorsement to another prison. Apparently, they had solid information that Sleepy, Chino, Paco, and Wino were all involved, but they weren't clear on me and Chente. We both decided to go back out to the yard, despite the fact that we knew we'd be huge targets and the Sureños would definitely attempt to retaliate against us. But we had no plans on going back out there to program or stay on the yard. We only agreed to go back out so we could get off again and try to bring in another wave. I was already planning on how I was going to do it as soon as I came out of committee. When we finally got back out, the yard was still slammed down and on modified program. I knew that the longer Chente and I stayed out there, the probability of us becoming targets ourselves increased by the minute. I quickly devised another plan. I wasn't about to wait for the lockdown to be lifted and for everybody to be released because things might go wrong really fast for us. I knew a lot of the other Northanos out there were straight cowards and that they probably would have sold us out to maintain peace. During the first couple of days after we touched back down on the yard, it became really obvious that none of them wanted to be around me or Chente. It was almost like we were treated like lepers, as if their association with us would somehow effectuate or transfuse into them becoming targets by the Sureños themselves. But that was okay with me because I didn't have any interest in being surrounded by a bunch of heartless riffraffs either way. My plan was now to hit the Sureño yard reps as the administration was actually allowing them to come out and make the rounds while we were programming. These weren't the prototypical yard reps either. Eddie Boy Capone and one of our original intended targets, Big Smokey from the harbor area, were designated as Sureño representatives. This was another golden opportunity to take out the rest of their leadership. Eddie Boy and Capone obviously felt played since I had deceived them about the rumor. I sensed this from them, but there was no obligation of loyalty amongst us, and I'm sure they respected this. In theory, their objective as Sureño representatives was to impel peace amongst the Sureño collective and provide daily progress reports to the administration to ensure the conflict was resolved before the lockdown was lifted. The administration would then tentatively agree to consider lifting the lockdown once these representatives ensured them that no more blood would be shed. But I knew this was completely contrary to what they were really doing. They had absolutely no interest in resolving this issue whatsoever, nor could they. Not after 9 of their comrades, homeboys, had been stabbed and outright disrespected. Instead, they were using this as a mere front and a means to facilitate communication from building to building. More than likely, to devise a plan of attack against us, which I'm sure specifically involved me and Chente. We were moved back to Building 5, but they put us in separate cells. The same night we got there, I got a cellie straight off the bus by the name of Eddie Capone Rodriguez from Stockton. His older brother, Johnny Cyclone Rodriguez, had just paroled and was someone who I became good friends with. As soon as Capone moved in my cell, I gave him a brief overview of everything that was happening and asked him flat out whether he wanted to go with us or not. Capone didn't even hesitate. He said he was with us and had no desire to stay on this yard. Not after everything I told him. 3 of us could do a lot of damage if this was done right. Meanwhile, the yard officers had gone through the yard with a fine-tooth comb using metal detectors. They dug up all the pieces we still had out there. They even found our stock. Time was now also becoming a factor. As much as I would have liked to wait to get my hands on solid steel, I just didn't have the time or resources. Instead, I had to improvise. I decided to make tomahawks, crude slashing weapons that are fashioned by melting 2 razor blades into the handle of a toothbrush or some other type of indurated stock that the blades can be attached to. The only problem was that I needed assistance getting enough razors to make them. I wasn't sure who I could and couldn't trust. Everyone was suspect, and I knew a lot of these guys were dropping kites to prevent anything else from happening. That night, I asked about 6 different black guys to get razors for me because I didn't even want to take a chance exposing my hands to the other North Daniels. It's sad to say, but that was the reality of it. As soon as I got all the razors, I made 3 tomahawks, 1 for me, 1 for Capone, and 1 for Chente. My plan was now to carry this out the following day in front of Building 1 when Eddie Boy, Capone, and Big Smokey started making their rounds. Later that night, me and Capone had all our property packed and I had the tomahawks all wrapped up in toilet paper on my shelf just in case they needed to be disposed of or flushed real fast. I knew there was a good chance we might get snitched on, so we were taking turns watching the outside door. Not even 5 minutes after I finished packing, I looked out the window and saw the front Sallyport doors leading into the building open and 6 officers came running in. Our cell was located on the upper tier, and as soon as they came through the door, they looked straight up at our cell. I knew somebody told on us. The eye contact was a dead giveaway. I grabbed the tomahawks and flushed them before they made it up the stairs. Me, Capone, and Chante were all cuffed up and escorted back to ADSE. This time our lockup order stated that we were being placed in ADSE due to multiple sources claiming that we were conspiring to assault Southern Hispanic inmates and planned on using weapons. This was discouraging, but also an eye-opener at the same time. It made me realize that some of my own people were now some of my biggest adversaries, and that trust in situations like this could never be taken for granted. Honestly, I was relieved to get off that yard and to get transferred somewhere else. But my trust and faith in my people was about to be tested again, and this time I was at the center of it.